Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to lecture number 10. And today we'll start from the first layer of semantic web, which is RDF, Resource Description Framework. So today we'll talk about some of the basic ideas of RDF. And in the next lecture, inshallah, we'll talk about the XML-based syntax of RDF, and we will discuss RDF schema. Well, the first thing first, we have an XML layer in the conventional web, and XML is also about metadata. So XML provides us a way to attach some information with the existing information on World Wide Web. But in semantic web, we propose to have another layer on top of it, in fact two more layers, RDF and ontology layer. They also serve the same purpose, to attach metadata with the data. Now let's see first of all the motivation for having these two layers on top of XML layer. Why we need to have these two layers? Now XML can be used to describe any data, but it does not provide any mean of talking about semantics, the meanings. Okay. So how to define, describe or understand the data, it is not there in XML. These capabilities are not provided by XML itself. Okay. For example, there's no intended meaning associated with nesting of tags. Now we can have parent-child tags, but what is the relationship between a parent tag and a child tag? It is up to each application how to interpret it, how to make sense of it. And let's see the ambiguity. The same structure can be used to describe completely different things, even the opposite things, or opposite structures can define the same things. So the idea is there's no inherent mechanism in XML to understand the content, to put semantics in the content. For example, let's take a very simple statement. David Billington is a lecturer of discrete math. If we want to make this statement in XML, we can have a course tag. This is a course tag. It closes over here. And inside course tag, we can have a lecturer tag. So the course name, this attribute value pair is saying that the name of the course is discrete math. And this parent tag, it has a child tag, lecturer. And the name of lecturer is David Billington. So this is perfectly legal in XML, okay, to have a tag, another child tag, to have some attribute value pairs inside the tag, right? Another way, we can encode the same information in another way, lecturer. We can have a lecturer tag, and inside, so this is lecturer is parent tag, and inside this we have a child tag which is teaches. So now we can have attribute value pair for lecturer. The name of lecturer is David Billington, and he teaches discrete math course. So now you see, opposite nesting, same information. We flip the order, parent and child. First, in first case, course was parent and lecturer was child tag. In the second, we made lecturer as parent and course as the child tag. Exactly same information can be represented by opposite nesting, by opposite parent-child relationship. Or still another way, we can describe the same information in this way as well. Like we have teaching offering parent tag, and it has two child tags, a lecturer and a course. Okay, so the lecturer is David Billington and course is discrete math. So now the same information can be represented in many different ways. So there is no intended meaning of parent and child relationship. Like I believe all of you are from computing domain, so you know that in object-oriented paradigm, okay, like object-oriented programming or object-oriented analysis and design, parent-child relationship has an associated meaning. It means a child will inherit all properties of the parent concept or a parent class or a parent object, and then it will have some unique properties as well. In case of XML, we do not have any intended meaning of parent-child relationship. Another way of expressing the information, here we have like information about a faculty member, about a lecturer. So we can have an academic staff member tag, and the value is, let's say, Greg Rosenthal, right? We can have a professor tag, and the value is Michael Mayer. We can have a course tag. Inside this, there is an is taught by relationship. So this person is also supposed to be an academic staff member. So a course cannot be taught by anyone other than academic staff member. Now, let's see another limitation in XML. Suppose we want to fetch the information about all academic staff members. Now, let's say if I present you this information, if this information is available, and I ask a person about, tell me about who are the academic staff members in this piece of information. So if I ask this this question from a person, he or she will tell me Gregorio Santonio, Michael Maher, and David Billington. All these three, they are academic staff members, because this is explicit academic staff member. Michael Maher is a professor. A professor, we all know, is also an academic staff member. And we also know that any course cannot be taught by someone other than an academic staff member. So for a person, all these three guys, they are academic staff members. But if we have presented the same information in XML, now I can write an XPath query. This is an XPath query used to query any XML document. We have an XPath query, which now this query will fetch all the tags tagged as academic staff members. Now this query, it will return only Gregorius Antonio, but it will not fetch Michael Maher. It will not fetch David Billington, because XML does not have semantics. The tags are there, but to make sense of these tags, you have to do a lot of extra work. It is not a generalized vehicle that can be used to make to build semantics on top of it. I hope you understand that XML, although it is used for content description, it is used for exchanging information between different systems. It is one of the most popular technology nowadays for all the system-to-system interfaces. But still, it has many limitations that need something more than XML, right? So XML is not enough to describe or understand the content for machines. So that is why we have another layer on top of XML layer, which is RDF, Resource Description Framework. Now the basic building block of RDF are, we call it triple: object, attribute, and value. Okay, so it is also called a statement. So sentence about Billington is such a statement. Just now we saw that, let's say, David Billington teaches discrete math course. So this is one statement which has lecturer as object, the attribute is teaches, and value is discrete math. So RDF is very simple and elegant framework. It has all the statements only in the form of triples: object, attribute, value, or sometimes we call it subject, predicate, object. Okay, predicate, sorry. Predicate, and this is object. So there are different terminologies used for it. So subject, predicate object, or object attribute value, or subject property value. There are many ways, but anyway, these are the three main components. We'll talk about them briefly. So RDF has been given a syntax in XML because RDF layer is built on top of XML layer. So it uses XML syntax, but there are other syntactic representations of RDF also. We'll see shortly. There are many other ways of representing the RDF statements, but XML remains to be the most popular format because of the obvious reason. It can be easily processed by the machines. So the fundamental concept, there are three fundamental concepts in RDF. We have resources, we have properties, we have statements. Let's see what are those. Resource, anything tangible or intangible that we can think about, anything that we can touch and feel, or anything that we can imagine, it is a resource. I hope you can relate it with Java or any other object-oriented paradigm. Just like in Java, everything is a thing. Anything that you can imagine, anything that you can touch and feel, or anything that you can think of, a physical or a logical entity, it is called an object. Similarly, it is called anything that we want to talk about, it is called a resource in RDF. For example, I may want to talk about an author, about a book, about publisher, place, people, hotel, computer, pen, paper, whatever. Every resource must have a URI, a uniform universal resource identifier, which can be a URL or some other, like in the last lecture we talked about URNs. Okay, so any identifier will suffice that can be used to identify any resource. So every resource will have an identifier, it is must. Property, these are special kind of resources. Properties are also resources, but they are special type of resources. What is special in them? They describe relationship between the other resources. So properties associate the different resources together. For example, is written by or written by property, it will associate a book with an author, right? So book is written by an author. Okay. Age. Okay, age will associate a person and a positive integer, or any living thing and a positive integer. Title will associate a book and a string. Okay, so the properties, they are used to associate the different resources together. They are also identified by URIs, just because they are resources, so they need to have some identifier, just like we discussed in the previous slide, that every resource must have a URI. It reduces the homonym problem, okay, of distributed data representation, because let's say we have discussed previously also polysemy and synonymy, one word having several meanings. Okay, so maybe let's say if I take you back to the semantic web first lecture, pipe. Okay, if I'm talking about a pipe, then which pipe I'm talking about? Okay, so similarly, this is noun. For verbs also, we might have same meanings, different meanings for the same word. So the context will depend on the domain, okay, in which we are describing that concept. So URIs will provide you a way of uniquely accessing or describing the properties. Okay, so the ambiguity will be removed by using a uniform resource identification mechanism. Statements assert the properties of resources. So statements are used to give values to the properties. So every object will have certain properties, and these properties are described by using statement. Okay, and a statement, as we just said, it is a triple, okay, which contains three things. The thing that we want to talk about, the property of that thing, and the value of that property. The values can be resources. Sometimes a property will associate a resource with another resource, or sometimes that can be literals. Literal means strings or numbers which are not resources. Okay, like age, someone has age, let's say 35. Now 35 is a literal. Someone has name, let's say Ali. Okay, now Ali is a literal, it is not a resource. So the values can associate the resource with a, the properties will associate a resource with another resource, or a resource with a string, literal string, or any other data type which cannot have any further properties. Okay, so mostly the resources, they are represented as ovals, and the literals, they are represented as rectangles in RDF graph notation. We'll see shortly. Okay, so there are different views of a statement, a triple, a piece of a graph, or a piece of XML code. So a statement can be seen, it can be visualized in many ways. We can think of it as a triple, subject, predicate, object. We can think of it as a graph, two nodes associated with an arc, okay? Or we can think of it as a piece of XML code. Now, whenever we are talking about something, it will not be only one statement. We will have several statements. So if we have several triples, then the RDF document will come a set of triples. If we have several pieces of graph, it will become a graph, a RDF document. And similarly, if we are describing the statements as XML, an RDF document will become an XML document. Let's see shortly and briefly what do you mean by them. Statements as triples. So here, again, the triples can be represented in different formats. So here we are saying that this website, this web page, okay, cit.gu.edu.au/db, it has site owner, okay. This is the subject, predicate or property is site owner, and the value is David Billington, okay. So this is a triple. So we can describe it this way, the triple XPY can be considered as a logical formula, PXY. It means it's a binary predicate P that relates two objects, object X and Y, okay? So a predicate or a property that describes or associates two objects together, X and Y. And in RDF, we can only have binary predicates. Here we have only two values, objects X and Y, that's it. We cannot have more than two values. We cannot have less than two as well. So a predicate or a statement will always associate two objects together, the object and the value. Similarly, we can think of an RDF statement as a graph. Same information is represented as a graph. Here you can see cit.gu.edu, this, it has site owner, and the value is David Billington, okay? So it is a directed graph with labeled nodes and arcs, okay? So first thing is, this graph has a direction. Here, look at the arrow. The arrow is pointing from subject to the value of the property. So it cannot be read this way. We cannot read it this way. It is wrong. It has a direction. Okay? It is a directed graph. The direction is always from subject or the object about which we want to make a statement, and then property, and then value of that property. It is from the resource to the value, right? It is known in artificial intelligence as a semantic network. Okay. The value of a statement may be a resource, and this resource may be linked to other resources. For example, here is an example of set of triples as a semantic net. Okay, so we have a website W3C. It is created by another resource. Ali has age 25. Ali has phone. This Ali studied at CCSIT, another resource. Ali knows Ahmed. Ahmed works at CCSIT. WCC.org works on www, and so on and so forth. So you can see that this graph will keep growing. All the statements, they associate the resources together, and those resources that are values of any property, they will have further properties, and so on and so forth. So here, as I told you before, the ovals, they represent resources which can have further properties. The literals, they are rectangles, and they cannot have further properties. Okay, they cannot have further properties. They are the terminal points. Okay. Similarly, an RDF document can be represented as XML syntax. Now, graphs, they are fine for human being. If I show this graph to a person, he or she can understand it very easily. But I cannot put this graph as an image in a machine and then to do any semantic processing on it, right? So for machines, an XML syntax is more powerful, it is more convenient, it is more easy to process, right? Like here, let's see briefly, inshallah, our next lecture is about XML syntax of RDF. Today we'll see very briefly, we are trying to introduce the basic concepts of RDF. Inshallah, in the next lecture, we'll talk about XML syntax in more detail. But anyway, first of all, this is an RDF document. It has two namespaces. We have defined RDF and we have my domain, okay? And we have a description, okay? RDF description, it closes here. Description about this person, this web page, and the property is site owner, and the value of this property is David Billington. Let's try to dissect this. An RDF document is represented by an XML element with the root tag of RDF. This is the root tag RDF. So every document in RDF will have root tag as RDF, and all the descriptions will be inside this root tag. Okay, RDF colon RDF. The content of this element is a number of descriptions with RDF description tags. So here inside this, we have only one description, but we will have several descriptions. Every description is a statement. And in an RDF document, we will have several statements. Like here, if I take you back, all these things, they are statements. This is one statement, okay? It is created by Ali. This is another statement. Ali has age 25. This is another statement. Ali studied at CCSIT. This is another statement. So every statement is represented by an RDF description tag. Every description makes a statement about a resource identified in three ways. Now in description, we are talking about resources. A resource can be described in three ways. Either we can have an RDF about attribute, which is referring to an existing resource. It means this resource is already there and we are making a statement about this resource. We can also have an ID attribute, which means that we are creating a resource in this document. You can create a new one. Or we can have anonymous resources as well, which is without a name. It doesn't have any name. So we say that, let's say, for example, over here, for example, if this is an anonymous resource, it is blank, there's nothing here. It means that W3C is created by someone, okay? So it means it is an anonymous, someone whose age is 25, whose phone is this, who knows Ahmed, and so on and so forth. So this will become an anonymous resource. So It is not very common, but we may have some anonymous resources as well. It means it does not have an identifier, but it is described by certain properties. Okay. Anyway, the most common are about or ID attribute. About means the resource already exists, and ID means the resource does not exist. We are creating a new resource. The RDF description element makes a statement about this resource, okay? And within the description, the property is used as a tag, and the content is the value of that property, okay? So here, the description, we are making the description about, we have given, so we are making a description about this thing, and the property is given as a tag. Now, site owner is a property. It is defined in my domain. It is defined here in this document. Okay, because this is the namespace, my domain. It means I'm taking the definition of site owner from this document, which is defined as my domain. Okay, so I'm taking the definition of site owner from where? The site owner is defined in this document. Inshallah, we'll talk about namespaces in the next document. If you're not familiar with XML, anyway. So the property is the tag, and the value, okay, of the property is the content of this tag. Okay, so the content of the tag is the value of the property. Okay, here this is the content of this tag. Okay, this is the content. So the property is site owner. So it, this statement is, it is essentially saying that this website has a site owner, and who is the site owner? David Billington. So we have subject in the description. We have three things. A description is a statement. So first, about or ID will identify the resource. Second, the property will be used as a tag. And the third, the value of the property will be given as the content of that tag. Okay. In RDF, it is possible to make statements about statements. One feature of RDF is to be able to make statement about a statement. Although it is to some extent controversial, some people are debating whether we should have this feature in RDF or not, but anyway, it is there. So you, if there's a statement and you want to express trust, belief, mistrust, liking, disliking, or anything, if you want to make a statement about that statement, you can do this through, we call it reification process. Okay. For example, Grigorous believes that David Billington is the creator of this website. Now, this thing is a statement, right? This thing is a statement. David Billington is the creator of this website. And now, we are making a statement about this statement. Grigorious believes this statement, right? Believes that the statement is true. Right, so this thing is called reification, to reify a statement. It means to make a statement about a statement. They can be used to describe belief or trust or liking, disliking, or anything that you want to say. The solution, how we achieve it, how we do it in RDF, it is to assign a unique identifier to each statement, which can be used to refer to that statement. So just like, I hope you understand the basic idea of RDF, that in RDF, everything that we want to talk about has an identifier, right? And then we can associate with a property, and property can have a value. So now we want to talk about this statement. So the idea is assign an identifier to this statement and then use it as a resource, as any other resource, just like when we are making a statement, an ordinary statement in RDF. Okay, so we introduce an auxiliary object, let's say belief 1, okay. So this entire belief, okay. So let's say Gregorius, so this is the subject, this is the property, and this is the belief, okay. So Gregorius believes this belief, okay. So he believes that the statement is true. So now this belief, what is this belief? If you go inside, the belief, it is related to each of the three parts of the original statement through the property subject, predicate, and object. So subject, the subject of belief will be David Billington. So this is, for this belief, this is the subject. Creator is the property, it is the predicate, and this value is the object, right? It is the object. Okay. I hope you get the basic idea that basically we want to make a statement. So every statement needs an object, subject, property, and object, right? So now in this case, the object is an entire statement. So we just call it, let's say, we call it a belief, and then we attach this belief with each one of the individual components of the statement, the subject, predicate, and object, right? So subject is David Billington, predicate is creator, and the object is the value of this property, this website, right? Next thing is data types. You know that in every thing that we do in computers, all the programming languages, all the frameworks, we have different data types. We have integers, we have strings, we have date, time, strings, characters, and so on and so forth. So they are commonly used in all the programming language. In RDF, type literals are used. It means every literal has a type, okay? Whether it is integer or a date or time or float, decimal, whatever. For example, here we have a simple example. David Billington has age. His age is 27. And the type, this is literal, and this is type. The type is integer, and where this integer is defined, it is defined in the standard XML schema. This XML schema document is used in all XML documents. So we are reusing the integer data type from the standard XML schema. So in RDF, mostly we use typed literals, okay, if it is necessary, we can have one type, but mostly we will use the type literal. We will use a literal, and this double hat is used to associate it with a type. Double hat notation indicates a type of the literal. In practice, most widely used data typing scheme will be the one by XML schema. The standard XML schema, the data types that are defined in it, we can use them. However, there is no restriction. You can use any externally defined data types. They are completely legal, they are allowed. You just have to refer them in an explicit way. For example, here we have given complete path, complete reference. Okay, this is the complete path where this data type is defined as a resource. So hash denotes a resource. So if you have made your own data types, you can refer to it by using the reference of that document and the identifier of that data type. Okay. So that's all. Today we have talked briefly about RDF. We already know that RDF is used to describe resources in semantic web. It is the first layer from where the semantic web starts. And today we saw what are the basic concepts in RDF. We talked about the statements, the properties, resources, and there are different ways of looking at an RDF document. So inshallah, in the next lecture we will go deeper. We will see the details of XML based syntax of RDF, and we will also try to study RDF schema, which is used to define the structure or vocabulary of the RDF documents. So that is all. Inshallah, in the next lecture, we will continue from this point forward. We will talk more about resource description framework and RDF schema. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.